gonna start?
No, we're not. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and everything in between, and welcome to the return of the Treblechin Nerdcast.
The Treblechin returns.
Ladies and gentlemen, and everything in between, I just want to say real quick, this is the return of the Treblechin Nerdcast. Welcome. If you've never been to a Nerdcast before, this is where me and Drew sit in a room, talk on a semi-topic, and talk on a topic that is predetermined, and
sometimes
discuss that. We had a important topic that we wanted to talk about, a semi-serious topic.
Yeah, it's a real problem.
About the state of video games kind of as a business, but it's Batman Day!
Yeah!
So we're gonna talk about Batman!
Batman!
Yeah, it's Batman Day. I found out today, like, I looked on Facebook and everybody's saying that it's Batman Day, so I'm
why
like...
Why is it Batman Day,
Davey? I don't know why it's Batman Day, Drew. I should have looked that up, but I didn't.
Was it the day that Batman was first released?
It's the day Batman was born.
You continue on with what you're saying.
But anyway, it's Batman Day. We've got this dumb Batman figure, because he's cool.
He's not dumb. I want him at a carnival. He's my favorite Batman figure.
So he's just going to be down here, where you can kind of see him the whole time. No, he's just going to be down there.
Batman Day.
Yeah, it's Batman Day. And I know I've said that 1,000 times, but I can't hold him up.
Where's your arm strength?
No, I can hold him up, but like I talk with my hands.
Yeah, that's fair.
But anyway, so we're just gonna kind of talk about like Batman, our favorite Batman video games, our favorite Batman comic books, our favorite Batman. Movies, TV movies, why Batman is so important to us, and just Batman.
The state of Batman.
Batman in general. Yeah, and yeah, the state of Batman, because we had Batman versus Superman that came out this year. We've got the Batfleck movie that is in production, and just a lot of Batman. A lot of Batman happening. Bat, 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 bat.
Oh, so like, starting this year, it is Batman Day.
Okay.
So, like, this is the first... This is the inaugural Batman Day.
This is the inaugural Batman... Man, I feel so privileged to do our Batman Nerdcast on the inaugural Batman Day.
Oh, wait, maybe not. Hold on. The annual fan favorite event... now in its third year. Okay.
Well, I guess not, Drew.
Well, the way that it said at the beginning of the article was saying that it was like the first Batman Day.
Ba-na-na-na-na.
Like, DC has made this now Batman Day.
Why? Does it say why?
The, was first introduced to the, introduced to honor the iconic character's 75th anniversary, continuing the Batman Day tradition. DC combined forces
with... So it's
with
the anniversary?
Yeah.
Okay. That's all we needed to know.
Yeah.
So yeah. Once again...
But there's like a ton of shit going on with Batman Day. Yeah. Like, DC has partnered with everybody.
For the 1,000th time, it is Batman Day.
Batman Day!
Batman Day! But yeah, let's start with Batman video games.
Yeah.
Batman's been present in video games for a very, 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 very long time.
He was kind of like one of the begin... He was like one of the first superhero games, wasn't he? Like on the NES?
There was an NES or Super NES game that was... Actually, no, there was a 1989 Batman video game. And there was a Batman Forever video game also. It was very bad.
Yeah. I would assume.
But Batman's kind of... Batman kind of has led the charge for
A lot of genres.
Well, he's led the charge for yes, a lot of genres, but also the resurgence of licensed video games very recently.
Oh yeah.
Because
Arkham Asylum was a fantastic video game.
Batman Arkham Asylum changed the way superhero video games were. In that it was a good game.
Like, yeah.
Like, not at that point, not since Spider-Man 2, the movie, the game, had there been a truly innovative superhero video game.
It also changed how, like, action games worked.
Yeah.
With its fighting mechanic.
Mm-hmm. But, like, yeah, the Batman Arkham game came out in 2008? Maybe later than that.
I want to say 2009.
Okay, maybe 2009. It came out a while ago. The 2000 single digits. Yeah. And it...
Before 10.
Before the 10. But it really kind of changed the way we thought of hand-to-hand combat in a... like, third-person action game that wasn't, like, a fighting game. Yeah. Like, it was it was the way it did the free-flowing combat and the way it kind of made you feel like Batman in a way that no other game had before it. Like, there were the side-scrollers on the NES and Super NES. There were a bunch of Batman the Animated Series-based video games that were...
Which were kind of top-down...
basically...
hack-and-slash games.
Either top-down hack-and-slash games or, like, the 3D version of Gauntlet, where you just kind of moved forward and beat the shit out of things.
It was a side-scroller in 3D.
Until you won... Like, you just
move. It was a 3D side-scroller.
Kind of, in a way. They were fun, because you got to be Batman, but yeah. The video game was kind of bad. Like, I remember renting one of the Batman games, I don't remember what it was called, but, like, you could, like, play as Batman, and Nightwing, and Robin, and Batgirl, and, like, it was just kind of walk forward, beat the shit out of guys, and there was co-op, so, like, you could beat the shit out of guys with your friends until you win. But, like, it wasn't really that fun looking back. It was just kind of, I'm Batman, and I get to punch.
Yeah.
Whereas Batman Arkham Asylum had detective stuff where, like, you...
Great detective stuff.
Pretty good detective stuff where you kind of would explore a crime scene and kind of find a clue and then follow that clue until you found...
Follow that man!
Yeah. Followed the clue until you found your objective and found the next point. And it had kind of like that Metroid abilities type situation where you're just like, okay... So I start kind of at base level and get new gadgets as I go through, and as I'm able to get Barbara Gordon to be able to send me these things or find my secret bat cave or whatever the hell. And once you get the gadgets, you can upgrade them to do better stuff as you see fit to kind of better how you can use them in combat or in stealth. And play your way. And it was pretty freaking cool. Mm-hmm. Like, it was... At the time, Arkham Asylum was one of, if not the greatest superhero video game ever made. And...
Video game.
One of the best games of the year. And
did it win Game of the Year?
No.
No?
I don't think so.
I thought it did.
It might have been nominated.
Okay. Because there was the Game of the Year edition.
No, yeah. It,
and I know
you
might
get
have won something.
You get a Game of the Year edition if you're nominated for Game of the Year or if one outlet gives you Game of the Year. Like, it's,
mm-hmm.
But anyway, yeah, it was... it. Started a resurgence for licensed games, superhero games, and all these things. And without it, we would not have Middle-Earth Shadow of Mordor, or the Deadpool game, or that Spider-Man game that's coming from Insomniac, that's gonna be on PS4, which I'm gonna play a lot, because I love Spider-Man. And, like, Spider-Man games... have been good in the past.
They've continued. Like, you've got Dimensions,
which is bad.
shattered something.
Okay, there's Shattered Dimensions and Edge of Time. Shattered Dimensions is meh.
Mm-hmm.
Edge of Time is terrible.
Oh, okay.
But the movie games, up until parts of 3,
mm-hmm.
like the first movie game and...
2 were great.
Spider-Man 2 were awesome. Ultimate Spider-Man, which was just a video game based in the Ultimate Spider-Man comic series,
yeah.
was phenomenal. And Spider-Man 3 was pretty good with the swinging mechanics. And Spider-Man Web of Shadows
yeah.
was fucking incredible. And Spider-Man's been a staple for... superhero games.
For a while, he forever. Was kind of the only one.
Yeah, he was the only one for a while, starting at about the PS1 generation. And Batman was kind of on the NES and the SNES, and then Batman kind of just washed away for a bit until Batman Begins, which was an okay game.
Was it?
It was okay.
I didn't think that came out.
No, it came out. There just wasn't a Dark Knight game.
Oh, okay.
There was going to be a Dark Knight game, but then it was just Arkham Asylum.
Yeah.
But there was going to be a Dark Knight game, and actually Monolith, who ended up making Shadow of Mordor, mm-hmm. were working on that before... Nolan pulled the plug on it.
Yeah.
So they just made Shadow of Mordor instead. So that's why Middle-earth Shadow of Mordor is basically an Arkham game.
Yeah.
Which, no argument here.
No.
But yeah.
Good game. I need to play it.
Yeah. But what's your favorite Arkham game?
That's real tough, because I love... Arkham Asylum.
Yeah.
So much.
Arkham Asylum was my favorite
mm-hmm.
for a long time.
Like, Arkham Knight, I liked a lot because it was, like, the most Batman-y.
That is. And I know this is blasphemy here on the internet, but Arkham Knight is my favorite Batman Arkham game.
Oh, no, for sure. Like, it's the most Batman-y of them. But the weirdest thing is, like, I can't remember a lot of Arkham City, which
That's
is
fair.
Real strange.
I remember a lot of Arkham City, and here's what I remember from Arkham City, and this is also blasphemy. Arkham City, narratively, is the worst.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's fucking terrible. Like, the narrative for Arkham City is kind of garbage.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's not much Joker. The other villains are pretty flat.
Mm-hmm.
And it just kind of ends out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Like, you're going through, you're doing your detective work, you fight Mr. Freeze, and that's cool.
Arguably, that was the best boss fight.
Yeah, you fight Mr. Freeze, and that's cool, and then you run into the League of Shadows, and that's okay. And then, like, you have all this face-off stuff while you're trying to figure out what Protocol 10 means and all that stuff, and then
a lot gets in the way.
You find out something that you probably could have assumed from the beginning, which a lot of people shit on Arkham Knight for having a plot point like that also. But what is Protocol 10? You could assume that it was blow up Arkham City. Like, what did you think it was?
Yeah.
Like, what is in your head that you just... That's not the first thing you think of.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you think of who's involved and why none of the inmates know what it is.
Yeah.
Of course they're gonna kill everybody. Of course they did that.
Yeah.
And then, oh shit, Talia al Ghul's dead. I didn't care. Mm-hmm. They didn't make me care. They should have made me care.
Yeah.
Oh, what? Plot point happened at the end. Oh, the game's over.
What? Yeah.
And Clayface, why?
Yeah.
Why Clayface? Oh, Joker's dead, why?
It was the best role possible.
Yeah.
It was the greatest role of a lifetime.
Yeah. Joker's dead, okay, good plot point. Wish you made me care. Wish Joker was in the game.
Yeah.
Joker's not really in that game, is he?
No, not a lot.
I mean, he is. But, like, he has one of my favorite lines in a video game right when you run into him for the first time, which takes a minute before it happens. And, like, he's like, it was all a lie. There's nothing wrong with you. Sweet of you to say, but you of all people should know there's plenty wrong with me.
Yeah.
Well, that's fucking awesome. And then he's just gone.
Yeah.
For, like, the majority of the game.
Yeah, no. But, like, gameplay-wise and playing that game...
Yeah.
...was great.
Yes. No, I... Mechanically, it improves in nearly every way on Arkham Asylum. Mm-hmm. And that's great for a sequel.
Yeah.
Like, that is awesome. Narratively, it takes a shit and falls off a cliff. And that's not good. Arkham Origins, which is widely renowned as the worst Arkham game, mm-hmm. which, from a gameplay perspective, I agree.
Yeah.
But, narratively, better than Arkham City, on par with Arkham Asylum.
Yeah.
Like, it's a really good comic book story. And it's old school Batman. Like, it's goofy. There's stuff that'll make you laugh. There's stuff that will make you scratch your head. There's stuff that'll make you cry if you're that kind of person.
Yeah.
Like, there's genuinely good writing and acting.
Yeah.
Like, Troy Baker as the Joker is fantastic. Whoever they got to play Bane is pretty scary.
Yeah.
And, like,
Even Batman was pretty good.
Yeah.
He
sounded like a young Kevin Conroy. Like, he was good.
Yeah.
All the voice actors in that game were great.
Although, to be fair, I don't think a young Kevin Conroy has ever existed.
Yeah, yeah, but you're right. But
I think he was born with his dulcet tones.
Yeah.
I require a bottle.
Mother, bring me the bottle. Step away from the door.
Mother, your breast.
Mother, I need your breast. No! Anyway. No, everybody, all the voice actors in that game perform phenomenally, and the story is really good.
Yeah.
And the writing is really good.
Yeah.
But it's buggy as hell. Like, it's fucking busted. And it falls...
Arkham Knight was also unplayable on PC at
release. PC?
Yeah.
But nothing else.
I never had any problems with Arkham Origins.
I had a lot of problems with Arkham Origins. And I played it after you. They should have fixed that time I got to it. But no, I had quite a few issues. Like, there were some points where my controller inputs would just stop responding.
Oh.
In a boss battle.
Oh.
And sometimes the
game... Maybe it was a Psycho Mantis.
Sometimes the game would lock... No, I was fighting Bane. That's the opposite of Psycho Mantis. it's...
Must kill the Batman!
And also... it was the first time you fight Bane.
Oh.
But anyway.
Okay.
Semantics. But...
Don't start your heart and kill you again!
Yeah, I had a lot of problems with that one. If you don't get that joke, go play the game. It's pretty good.
Yeah.
It's worth a playthrough. But anyway,
oh, definitely.
One of the biggest sins for Arkham Origins is the fact that it didn't understand the formula of the Arkham games. Like, it fell very noticeably into, now you're beating dudes up, now you're sneaking around, now you're beating dudes up, now you're sneaking around, now you're beating dudes up, now you're doing detective stuff.
And now you're
beating
around.
Dudes up. Now you're sneaking around. Now you're beating dudes up. And it's just so... And I got real bored with the game part of the game real quick. And here's a boss battle. Now you're beating dudes up. Now you're sneaking around.
Yeah.
It's not a great game.
No, but I think I would rank it like second or third for me. I think Arkham Knight would be my number one.
I would rank it last, but not a distant last.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for me,
like, I only do because I love, like, for me, a lot of the times the story is the main point.
I understand that completely. I kind of like a mixture.
Yeah.
And like, I like a well-mixed mixture, okay? And the thing with Arkham Origins is the story, the flavor is very good. Like, the flavor's up here, gameplay's way down here with the flavor.
So it averages
into... it averages into meh.
Yeah.
Whereas Arkham City, gameplay's really high up here. Like, really, really good. And story's kinda here.
Mm-hmm.
So it averages out to be a little higher.
Yeah.
With
And that is fair.
Now
I just don't remember like hardly anything from Arkham City. Yeah. I kind of remember the Catwoman story more than the Batman story. At times.
That was day one DLC.
Yeah, that's next week.
Yeah, but I don't know. For me, it goes Arkham Knight.
Yeah.
Arkham Asylum.
Hmm.
Because Arkham Asylum gameplay and what it set in terms of what it set out to do, gameplay and story are about like this. But up here. It averages out to be real good. And I think the story, and once again, blasphemy on the internet apparently, I think the story in Arkham Knight is unmatched.
Oh, yeah.
Like, unmatched. And
my only problem with Arkham Knight
is this namesake.
No. Like my,
because that's my issue.
my problem was like the towards the end, the tank battles got a little bit repetitive.
Yeah,
and like unfun at times when it's just like
the very last tank battle for sure, 100%.
I was fine with that because it was something new. Yeah. But the one before that, to where it's like, here's 40 dudes! Eat it! I was like, mother fucking god! Why?
Choose them.
Yeah, like, it just kept building up more and more to where it's like, I just don't want to do this anymore. And then it throws that at me. Like, yeah. I want some flavor. And it throws that, I'm like, fuck you!
Yeah. Okay.
And then there was like actual thought put into the final one. Like, okay, yeah. That's fine. Let me run over these jokers.
Yeah. But I want to talk for a minute about like the way it breaks down for me on Arkham Knight, and let me explain why I think.
Let's
broaden our minds. I want to explain why I think the story is the best, because I get the points people make to the respect that it is not great. I get the points, but they're wrong. And let me tell you why. everyone's point on this game being bad is the tank combat, which is understandable if that's not your thing. Like, I had a lot of fun with it.
Oh, yeah, no, it was fun. It just got real repetitive at the end.
I didn't even care, because I just had fun. I had fun watching those things blow up. Mm. Like that, and when they threw more at me, I'm just like, but like that's just me. That's fine, whatever. And I understand why the tank combat annoyed some people, but they exaggerate how much there actually was. But the main issue for the narrative for people is its namesake. The game's namesake, which is the Arkham Knight, which the game should have been called something else.
Yeah.
Like, and I know you need brand synergy, so the word Arkham needs to be in there, because without that, you're going to fall into an issue with the Modern Warfare games we're going to fall into, because Modern Warfare 2 was just going to be called Modern Warfare.
Yeah.
It was just going to be called Modern Warfare 2, but they ran some tests, and nobody knew what it was.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to put Call of Duty back on the name. Fine, whatever. You gotta have Arkham in the name, but, like, figure something else out.
Yeah.
Because that was the biggest problem you had, was it, the game was centered, was made you think it was supposed to be centered around this character that you knew who he was. And they acted like, they did act in a lot of spots like it was supposed to be this groundbreaking reveal that it was, spoilers, that it was Jason Todd.
Yeah.
But, like, but, and they just shouldn't have done that. Like, the first off, game shouldn't have been called Arkham Knight. The villain shouldn't have been called Arkham Knight. Make it Red Hood, which you did by the end anyway.
Yeah.
But make it Red Hood so there's you can at least pretend that it's that it was supposed to be a dramatic irony. Like, you know who it is, but he doesn't.
Yeah.
Like, and like that's fine. That's great.
Yeah.
But why that doesn't kill the narrative is because the game's not actually about that.
No.
They make it they make you feel like it's supposed to be about that because the game is called Arkham Knight, and they keep shoving him in your face in spots. But that is not what that narrative is about, and if you're actually looking at what the story is about, there is no mistake about what the game is about. And this game is about Batman's failures. It is about his failures with Jason Todd, with Barbara Gordon, with Tim Drake, and with the Joker.
Yeah.
And it is about his final and ultimate battle with the Joker inside the black matter of his mind.
Gray matter.
Fuck you. I was making a Mad Max reference. Anyway. No, it's just, it's because if he kills the Joker, if the Joker ever dies in a Batman story, that is not the end of the Joker. Mm-mm. The end of the Joker is when Batman finally gets rid of the memory, the thought of the Joker. Because the Joker is not a physical challenge. The Joker is not a challenge of, like, can I figure out how to stop him from blowing stuff up. Yeah, that's going on.
Yeah.
Sometimes he's fighting the Joker, sometimes he's trying to stop him from blowing stuff up, but the actual contest of the Joker is a contest of the brain. is a contest of proving that you are better than him. It's a contest of proving that not everyone will end up like that if given the right push.
If they just have one bad day.
And that's what The Dark Knight was about.
Mm-hmm.
The Dark Knight, in essence, in the bottom of it, was the Killing Joke.
Yeah.
Like, the interaction with Harvey Dent was what Joker was trying to prove in the Killing Joke. Is that even someone as good and as morally north as the Harvey Dent they created for The Dark Knight, because a lot of people write Harvey Dent as, like, maybe he'll end up to be crazy or a scumbag later. Mm-hmm. Like, he's written to be, he's saying good stuff, but he seems like kind of a piece of shit.
He's got problems.
Whereas in The Dark Knight, like, he is so fixated on being the hero that Gotham deserves, the hero that, and saving this city that he loves from the dark corruption, and he's willing to dip his toe into the black in order to see the way that it thinks, in order to see how how it goes, but then he falls too deep.
Yeah.
And the Joker grabs him. And that is the contest between Batman and the Joker. The feeling of, like, I can't let him win.
Mm-hmm.
Because the minute I beat him, he wins. The minute I do the one thing that will stop him, he has beaten me.
Yeah.
And that, the end of Arkham Knight, with the battle with the Joker inside Batman's head, with the Joker, with the Scarecrow toxin,
yeah,
is Batman finally defeating the Joker. Because in Arkham City, he doesn't kill the Joker.
Mm-mm.
The Joker dies. The Joker dies from the toxin that he created, that he gave himself.
Mm-hmm.
But he still lives within Batman. And seeing that ending where Batman takes him and puts him into this isolation chamber, rolling back into the deepest recesses of his mind where he will never be found again,
mm-hmm,
is just that symbolic defeat that is probably the greatest ending to a God and Lucifer struggle that there has ever been in, definitely in comic books.
Yeah.
But comic books that I've read, at least. But one of the best in literature.
Yeah.
Including the Bible.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that the ending of the Darkham Knight.
That's what it should have been called.
The Darkham Knight. No. The ending of Arkham Knight, like, the real ending aside, the real ending aside, because that's another issue that they made you, like, 100% to actually get the true ending. But, like, the true ending for me was
that,
and what came after, which is him standing on a rooftop, knowing that he can no longer be Batman anymore.
Mm-hmm.
After tonight, but also knowing that he doesn't need to be.
Yeah.
And that could have been the end. And the actual end is a little underwhelming.
Mm.
But I don't know. Having that mental struggle with the Joker in a game and done the way that they did it is good enough to make it the best of the Arkham series, because they all have issues with narrative.
Mm.
Rocksteady's just not that great at narrative. And that's fine, because they made you feel like you were Batman. Like, that's good enough.
Yeah.
But, like, I don't know. The story in Arkham Asylum, in my opinion, is the most consistently good.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it has the smallest divots and rises. But overall, I'd say Arkham Knight is the best narratively, the best mechanically, and the best graphically.
Well, yeah.
Like, it's just...
Of course it would be, but, you know.
It's amazing. Like, I love it. Fuck yeah. You, internet.
Yeah, no, it's great.
But, you talk. What do you want to talk about?
Well, let's, how about we talk about Batman and movies?
Okay!
And, like...
I kind of did that a little bit, but that's cool.
Well, I mean, like, movies now versus, like, before. Because okay. Batman v Superman is a thing, and...
Okay, let's...
Suicide Squad, and...
Yeah. Well, let's...
Justice League.
Let's talk about...
already.
Let's talk about Batman movies. Have you seen... Have you seen the 1960s Batman movie?
I have seen half of it.
You can't really watch all of it, can you?
Oh, no, I'm sure that I could, but I watched half of it in the car one time, like, riding with my grandparents, because they had a DVD thing.
It's so corny.
Oh, so corny. We should watch it.
It is a corn on the cob.
It's a cornfield.
Yeah, it is a field of corn. Get me, Robin, hand me the shark repellent.
Hand me the bat shark repellent.
What the fuck is that?
Robin, sometimes you just can't get rid of a bomb. Pulling my leg, the Joker did it.
It's so stupid. It's so bad. Like, it's so bad. I mean, like, that's what everybody thought a comic book movie had to be. Like, it had to be this silly, ridiculous, stupid thing. Well, it was
during the Silver Age.
Yeah.
So, like, there was no killing or any of that. It was all fun and games.
Yeah. Until someone loses an eye.
Well, until someone decided, fuck this!
Until you can get rid of a bomb. No, but until Tim Burton decided, fuck this!
No, until Marvel decided, you know, what if we just didn't put the Senate approval on comics?
Yeah.
And they started doing that, and then everyone else was like, yeah! Yeah.
It's like, there are still comic books where, like, killing's not allowed, whatever the fuck. Like, all ages approve, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
But you want
the kids to read comic books. Get them, start them early.
You want the kids to read
comics. That college fund, you don't need that, kid. You got comics.
The kids got the other C. Yeah,
the kids
can still read comic books, but there's the whole parental advisory section of the comic book store, which, like, has Wolverine Weapon X and The Dark Knight Returns and Sin City.
Where do you shop for comics?
Sometimes. I'm not sure what I meant to say there.
Because I go to an actual comic store.
Yeah.
And it's just comics.
Yeah.
Comics everywhere.
Yeah, there's...
Let's broaden our minds.
There's comics everywhere, but, like, there's...
Oh, Alex is playing Civ.
No, like, there's very clear areas where it's like, okay, this is the kid stuff, this is the grown-up stuff.
Yeah.
And, like, most of the time, like, the kid stuff is housed in the Marvel and DC sections. There are kid stuff sprinkled throughout the rest of the stuff, but for the most part, the midsection is where the cleavage is.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's not exclusively cleavage, but it's...
Sometimes it's ass.
Yeah, sometimes it's butt cleavage. But the point is, like...
Comics for adults.
The point is, the start of comic books was like, I got a box of comic strips, we can read them together!
Yeah.
And whereas nowadays it's like, okay, you can read that, and I'm gonna read this. And like, there are grown-up and kid versions of just about everything, except like, very specifically kid things, like in the Peanuts and...
Adventure Time comics, My Little Pony comics,
SpongeBob comics, yeah. Avatar the Last Airbender comics.
Which I've heard are fantastic, yeah. By the way.
Oh, there's a Dark Horse series that's, I think, about to start up, if it hasn't started up, that is supposed to be the continuation of Avatar the Last Airbender.
Oh, another one? Yeah. Nice.
Once comic books kind of decided, what if we could become...
What if bears?
What if we could be a little bit of something for everybody? Mm-hmm. And that's when, like, stuff started to get dark, and that's when the Punisher movie came out in the 70s.
Yeah.
Which, it was garbage. Mm. But... It was an R-rated superhero movie.
Yeah.
Back when nobody thought that could be a thing.
Well, also, rated R was a lot easier to get.
Yeah, but it was a violent superhero movie.
Mm.
And, like...
It's weird how R was, like, both easier to get and should have been on some things back then.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird balance thing on yeah. that. But, The Punisher movie happened, and it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But the
Russian fight scene's good.
Yeah. The Batman 1989, directed by Tim Burton, was kind of the beginning of what we think of superhero movies today.
And it's basically still the model, almost.
A little bit, yeah.
Like, it's like the first one that people look to, like they'll look at other movies and yeah. be like, dude, is this what this is supposed to be? Yeah.
Yeah. All
right, but is it like Batman 89? And they're like, no, but okay, make it a little bit more like that.
Well, here's what happened. Like Batman 1989 is kind of the centerpiece. Okay. Like it's kind of like where everything branches off from right now. Or at least back when Avengers and the Chris Nolan Batman series coexisted.
Yeah.
Here's the center, over here is dark, over here is silly. Marvel started to move this way, DC started to move this way, and that's still kind of the way it is, but...
Which is unfortunate.
Yeah, like... But the thing is... Batman 1989 is a goofy-ass movie.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's a silly fucking movie.
Joker's plot was to put poison in makeup.
Yeah.
And, like, bodily products in the whole town. And so, nobody wore makeup.
Yeah.
In the whole town.
It was a Tim Burton movie.
I know!
It was a silly Tim Burton movie, and it was fucking great.
Yeah.
But, like, Christopher Nolan did the dark Batman correctly. Like,
Batman killed a lot of people in that movie.
Yeah, Batman killed a lot of people in Batman. not as much in Batman 1989, but he killed a lot of people.
He
blew a dude up in Batman Returns.
Was after this.
Yeah, but in Batman Returns, he blew a dude up and like looked at the bomb that was strapped to the guy's chest and grinned. That happened in Batman Returns. That was the most fucked up one. It's like he sees the guy, he's got the bomb strapped to his chest and he can't get it off, and Michael Keaton's just sitting there like that's so weird and kind of fucked up. Like, real bad.
Tim Burton.
It's a Tim Burton movie.
But, like, one of them, like, he's on the big tower, and, like, there's the big brute dude, and he just, like, jujitsu and throws him off the building.
Yeah.
Like, that dude's dead.
Yep.
That dude fell stories.
There were a couple moments like that, because me, Jeffrey, and Steven went to go see Batman 1989 at the Alamo in 35mm, which is gorgeous.
I saw Monday Night Raw.
WWE
Monday Night Raw. On my belts over but there. Like,
1989 Batman on film with that film sound. Ugh.
Yeah. Whenever you told me that after the fact, I'm like, oh, that sounded real cool.
I saw Heat. That's what they were showing Heat in also, mm-hmm. when I went and saw it on my birthday. Like, nice. Why don't they show movies on film anymore? I know it's because it's incredibly cumbersome and horrible, but it looks and sounds so much better than the digital shit. Cheaper. I know digital's cheaper, but the thing is, a lot of filmmakers are still filming on film. It's just being converted to digital.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, on the filmmaking side, still happening.
Yeah.
And that's like your Tarantino's and your Christopher Nolan's. Like, I think they filmed Interstellar on 35mm film.
Okay.
And they filmed The Hateful Eight on 70mm film.
Yeah.
Which, I saw that in 70mm.
Yeah.
It's so good.
This is Batman.
I know, but...
What if Tarantino made a Batman movie?
Film, bro. Film.
What if Tarantino made a Batman movie?
I want it. I want Tarantino to make all films.
I don't know if he could do all films.
I want him to make kids' movies. I want to see what that happens.
Robert Rodriguez.
They're not the same thing.
I know. But...
I understand what you're saying. But they're not the same thing. In terms of, like...
This is Batman.
I know. But in terms of, like, making a movie that has, like... a consistent narrative. I know this is hard to believe, but Tarantino is the better of those two.
Yeah.
Like, if you haven't seen a Robert Rodriguez movie, that's probably hard to believe. But it's true.
Machete was born in Spy Kids.
Machete's so good. This is Batman.
Machete as Batman.
Stop the presses! What if... And this is crazy. Danny Trejo...
Was Batman.
Or Robin. What if Samuel L. Jackson was Batman... And Danny Trejo was Robin? That doesn't make any sense, because Danny Trejo is quite a bit older. Maybe not quite a bit older, but I'm pretty sure he's older.
Yeah.
But...
What if Danny Trejo was Alfred?
What if bears?
let's get back to Batman stuff. We had Batman Returns. It's good as always.
It's more Tim Burton Batman, which is fucking great.
Yeah.
Got then, fucking Danny DeVito as the Penguin, which is silly as hell and kind of terrifying.
Yeah.
And he bites the perfect cast. Bites off a dude's nose.
Yeah.
Christopher Walken's in there. Billy Dee Williams is still Harvey Dent.
Isn't he?
Why did that go away?
Because
Tim Burton gave up?
Because Joel Schumacher happened. We can have different opinions on this, but I think we have about the same here. Batman Forever. Jim Carrey as the Riddler.
Is the best.
Could, yeah, it's like the best thing on there.
Yeah.
But, like,
if they reined him back a little bit, would have been real great.
Here's what's weird, though.
Two-Face should have been the Joker.
Yeah. Here's what's weird, though. Like, Tommy Lee Jones out Jim Carrey's Jim Carrey in that movie, and that's weird.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay. I talked to Jeffrey about Batman a lot.
Yeah.
Because, you know. But
as you do.
As you do. I talked to Jeffrey about Batman a lot. And Batman Forever, we talk about it. He says Tommy Lee Jones is bad. No, he's playing the wrong character.
Yeah.
Yes, as Two-Face, Tommy Lee Jones is not
horrible.
But he's all right. Like, mm-hmm. Tommy Lee Jones is not a bad actor.
No.
He's actually one of the best actors. But,
I think either it was... Either, like, he was told to do the Joker, and they couldn't do that for whatever reason, so they switched it to Two-Face and just didn't have him change character.
Here's what's weird, though. Like, that movie feels like it's kind of half trying to be in the universe of the Tim Burton movies and half not.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's weird, because, like, they were kind of trying to do the sequel to Batman Returns, but...
And then something went astray.
So they couldn't have the Joker, because the Joker's dead?
Mm-hmm. Or is he? Or is he?
But, like, Batman Forever, I consistently say, is an okay Batman movie that had a bad Batman. Because Val Kilmer's not great.
Yeah, he played a better Bruce Wayne than I think Michael Keaton even. But as Batman, no. Like, yeah. Michael Keaton was a great Batman.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm not a huge fan of Val Kilmer just as an actor. Okay, I want to do this real quick for the camera, but...
If you don't know what we're talking about, in Batman...
There is a scene in Batman 1989 where he is running down the alley from a bunch of criminals with Vicky Vale and has to look up to see, like, a balcony upside, and he literally does this.
Because...
He can't move his neck!
The way that they built the cowl, the whole cowl and the shoulders... are one piece. So, like, there's a lot of, through the movie, like, he has to turn his whole body because he can't move his neck. And so he has to...
they make a joke about that in Dark Knight.
Yeah.
It's like the original Dark Knight Batsuit was similar, not as bad.
Yeah.
But, the Batman Begins Batsuit and for the beginning of the Dark Knight, and then they change that.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a funny joke, because...
and ill-fitting belts.
Yeah. But, yeah.
But, yeah, Val Kilmer was, I think, like a good Bruce Wayne.
Yeah. And here's my opinion. I think... George Clooney would have been a great Batman if he was given a good Batman movie.
He would have been a great Bruce Wayne if they let him be Bruce Wayne in that movie, because George Clooney basically lives the life of what people think Bruce Wayne does.
George Clooney would have been a great Bruce Wayne. I think he would be a hella good Batman.
If he was allowed to be serious.
Yeah.
But here was the problem. Joel Schumacher making a more kid-friendly film, they're like, yeah, do that. And so he made a more family-friendly movie, but he had to put, like, stupid things in there for the adults as, like silly little jokes.
Yeah.
And so they had bat nipples and bat asses.
That's still one of my favorite scenes in a Batman movie. That's like close up on George Clooney's bat butt. Just, why did you do this?
Here's the thing, though. Here's the thing. People were like, why would you not do that for Batgirl? The thing is, they did, and they lost the costume. So they had to make another one and didn't have time to put the nipples and the ass on it. Yeah!
I feel like somebody burned that suit.
I feel so, too!
Like, somebody's just like, this can't happen!
Yeah. And so...
Like, that's something that would be iffy to fly at that time. It would be just completely ripped a new one today.
Oh, yeah.
But back then, it would have been bad.
Yeah. So, there's some fun trivia for you. Batgirl was going to have bat nipples and bat ass before, mysteriously, that costume disappeared and they had to rush another one.
All right, no nipples.
Yeah.
Get rid of that.
No, they're like, well, we don't have time. Just get it on her and go.
That movie's really bad.
Yeah, oh, yeah, fuck. Okay, so...
But I feel like if George Clooney wasn't known as the Batman from the literal worst Batman movie, I feel like he might have been in the running for a future Batman movie.
Maybe. Because, he's got the drama chops.
He's got the drama chops. He's done action movies. He can beat the shit out of people.
He's got charisma out the ass.
He's got charisma out the ass, so that's the Bruce Wayne part. He's got the chin.
Yeah.
You need the chin. Kilmer doesn't have the chin. Val Kilmer's got weird-ass lips.
All right.
He does. So, especially back then. Like, now it's less... So, because, he's gotten a little bit pudgier, so it's, more in proportion with the rest of his face. But, I saw Heat.
I'm Batman.
I saw Heat back, yeah.
So, it's just...
I saw Heat on my birthday, and I'm like, Val Kilmer's got weird lips.
I'm making time for fighting. I'm making time for hitting. We'll meet and I will beat you.
We'll talk about that later.
Permitting.
We'll talk about that later. But, we had Chris O'Donnell, who was in Batman Forever, who came in there.
Yeah.
He's a whiny bitch in this.
He's bad.
Yeah.
He was bad in Batman Forever.
Yeah, but, I mean, he was, worse.
Holy guacamole, Batman.
That would have been a welcome.
Or something of the like.
Yeah. I kind of liked the Alfred from the Burton movies and those movies.
Oh, yeah, he's great.
He's arguably, one of my favorite Alfreds.
He's really good. There. And weirdly enough, Michael Caine, I love Michael Caine.
Mm-hmm.
And I like him better than that guy, but that's just me.
Yeah.
I love Michael Caine, but I think Jeremy Irons... is probably the best Alfred there's ever been.
Oh yeah, no, for sure. But I mean, the movie, the old movies, Alfred, he had the look and he had the sound.
Yes.
To be Alfred,
for sure.
So he wasn't necessarily the best, but he was the most Alfred of Alfreds. Oh, yeah,
the only thing that
wouldn't have made sense, but make him even better would be old CIA Alfred.
Yeah.
He could still beat the shit out of people like Superman.
Like they're doing... yeah, like they did with that Gotham TV show, which is... You know how you've heard mixed reviews? The quality of that show is mixed.
Yeah.
Because there are stretches of that show that are phenomenal. Then there are bad episodes.
Yeah.
And the bad episodes are very bad.
Mm.
But that's... Yeah.
Yeah.
We can talk about that later.
Yeah, we haven't gotten there. And Arnold Schwarzenegger as Mr. Freeze.
Yes, of course you did that. But at the same time, why did you do that?
He was Arnold Schwarzenegger coming out of the 80s and the 90s. Yeah. So, like, why would you not when you need this big dude in a suit?
Yeah. But why wouldn't you get tickets to this? Of course you got tickets to this.
But then also the flip side of that was it was Arnold Schwarzenegger in the 90s.
Yeah.
Ouch.
He's bad.
But the funny thing is, when I go and watch that, he's the best part of that.
Yeah.
Because he's accepted that this is a dumb movie and this is the worst thing ever. So he just runs with it. Yeah. He is the running man.
For sure. No,
for sure. So, like, people say this is the worst movie. Yes, but Arnold makes it the best.
Yeah. I hate when people talk during the movie.
What killed the dinosaurs? The Ice Age! Ice to see you!
And his minions were hockey players.
And one of them was Bane. A lot of people forget about that.
Yeah, Bane was a thing.
Bane was in that movie.
Yeah, we don't talk about
that.
He
was just a meathead.
Also, there was a whole scene where fucking Robin and Batman were, like, fighting over were they paying each other off to get away from Poison Ivy, or were they fighting over to treat Poison Ivy like a hooker?
The latter.
Because there's a part where
it comes.
There's the Batman credit card.
God fucking damn it!
I was just like... Like, that's one of the few things I remember from that movie, because I haven't really watched it since I was a kid. Well, there was the Batman credit card, and I'm like, dog, that has your information on it. Like, people are going to find out who you are. Like, either you went to the bank as Bruce Wayne and asked to set up a credit card account for Batman, which, like, that's a red flag. Or that has Bruce Wayne's name on it. Or
you
went to the bank as Batman. Which, that's about as ridiculous as that scene in The Killing Joke where Batman comes up and brings Batgirl coffee in his Batman costume. Like, did you go to Starbucks as Batman?
Did you steal the coffee?
Did you take the coffee?
Do you just have a percolator in that belt? It's a bat percolator.
But that's a different thing.
Bat coffee.
Well, we'll talk about that later. The Batman credit card. So, yeah. I think the Batman credit card's hilarious, but apparently it angers Drew.
It's funny.
Either you went to the bank as... Because you have to go to the bank to do that.
In the 90s, yeah.
Yeah. Or you sent Alfred to do it.
But he's Alfred.
But he's Alfred and everybody knows he works for the Waynes.
Did you send Alfred in the Batman suit?
Did you send Alfred in the Batman suit in case somebody caught him? Did you just send a random kid on the street with a ski mask on? Like, did you say, hey, I need you to go to the bank for me real quick. How did you do this?
I don't want to think about
it. I want to think about
no.
it.
No.
Let's break this down.
No. How let's move on.
How in the fuck?
Batman the Animated Series.
How in the fuck does that Batman credit card exist? Tell me this. I want someone to tell me right now. No one's going to tell me right now, but I want someone to tell me eventually. Because I want to know. Can you show me?
Does it smell like chloroform?
So, Batman the Animated Series. You have watched an immensely more of this than I have.
Yes, it's so great.
But, yeah, Batman the Animated Series is...
So, it started 92?
Yeah, 92.
I think, yeah.
1992.
So it's older than us.
Yeah.
So that makes us feel young.
You make me...
Hold on.
You make me feel so young.
You make me feel like spring has sprung.
You make me feel like there are bells to be rung, songs to be sung,
and a wonderful thing to be flung.
Oh, you make me feel so young.
Even when I'm old and gray.
Anyway.
You make me feel like I do. Today.
Yep. Anyway,
so,
but Batman the Animated Series is really, really well animated, really, really, and
it was like so. I showed you Batman: Master of the Phantasm, which came out like about midway through the animated series run.
Mm-hmm.
Hammered Bat.
Hold on. Say cheese.
And so, like, the Batman the Animated Series, for back then with cartoons, because, like, back then we were at the end of the 90s era, end of the 80s era, where you had Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, you had all of these great cartoons that
Teenage
were happening,
and
they were all to sell toys.
Yeah.
Because no,
for sure.
That's how the 80s worked.
But Batman was not to sell toys. He did.
Like,
sell toys, he did. Because look at what I have in my hand.
Schumacher happened, but, you know.
Yeah.
And then, because Schumacher made movies to make toys.
Okay, look at this toy.
Uh-huh.
Look at the way his face is put on his face. Like, it looks like the face is a separate thing.
I think it is.
Like, it, yeah.
I think there's a face under that mask. Who could be under that mask? Don't take it off!
Don't unmask him, that's the ultimate shame!
Shame. But, so, like, Batman the Animated Series was, like, the first to do a lot of things in television.
The first to be a kid... One of the first to be a kid's show that wasn't entirely a kid's show.
Oh no,
that was well,
like
no.
it was meant to be like,
I mean, not
a show
first,
for everybody, but it was gritty and dark,
yeah,
for a kid's show.
Yeah,
and no one had done that before.
Yeah.
It was also the first to have its own orchestra for the music,
yeah,
for every episode.
Yeah.
Done by Danny Elfman.
Yeah.
So, like, on top of having all this animation, you had an orchestra for all of it.
Danny Elfman's great.
Yeah. And, like, the stories that they would tell were, like, ranged from either, like, completely silly and over the top, as Batman does.
Yeah. Was Polka Dot Man in the animated series?
Yes.
Okay.
As well as Calendar Man and the Clockwork King.
Yeah, and
like there were all the silly ones were
the ventriloquist and Scarface. And
yes,
I love them.
Yeah, they're great. But then you would also have episodes to where like people would legitimately die.
Yeah,
or
most of them were Joker episodes.
You watched Harvey Dent lose it.
Yeah,
because like in the first season, Harvey Dent is Harvey Dent the defense attorney.
The district attorney.
Yeah. And then, like, in the middle of, I think, season two or so, we get an episode to where he is, like, in a psychiatrist's office to where they're like, can we speak to Harvey now?
Harvey's not here.
Yeah.
And it's Two-Face speaking, and we watch, basically, the fall of Harvey Dent, and throughout the show, Harvey's still there.
Yeah.
And him and Two-Face have a struggle.
Yeah.
And it shows you all of that, as well as, like, Clayface's fall. Like, there's, like, emotion towards the villains to make you care about them.
Yeah.
and they're not just like fodder of the week. Like, there's an episode to where Penguin goes straight.
Yeah.
Like, he stops crime. He comes out of jail. He gets out. He's going to turn his life around.
Yeah.
And so he tries to get into the, like, high-class order of people.
Yeah.
And two of the, like, this one chick and this one rich guy are like, let's play a game. You're going to go out with the Penguin, and we're going to make fun of, like, how actually disgusting he is, because like, he sings at an opera, he eats like an animal, kind of. He wants to be this like sophisticated rich person, but he's not actually. And the chick kind of starts feeling for him, what turns out to be like what was first a joke. She's kind of, like, warming up to Penguin.
Yeah.
And Penguin wants to get in, like, a more serious relationship. And then he overhears the two talking, and she's telling him, like, you know, he's actually got kind of a charm to him.
Yeah.
And then Penguin, like, turns evil and kidnaps the chick.
Yeah.
And when Batman shows up to put him back in jail, like, Penguin kind of breaks down, like... things were going so well, but it turns out that I can't do any of this. I can't be a normal person.
Yeah.
And so it's like, you feel for Penguin, who up to that point was the worst shitbag in the show. Like, Joker is Joker, regardless, but in terms of, like, other villains, Penguin's the biggest shitbag.
Yeah. I mean...
And then...
In the Batman, that's true also.
And then, like, with, like, basically every Scarecrow episode...
Yeah.
...was basically a psychology lesson.
I've seen a couple of those Scarecrow episodes.
Like, a psychology lesson and a kind of, reality-shattering, like, facts of humans...
Yeah.
...type of thing, which I'm watching it as an adult... well, I watched it in high school.
Yeah.
And watching that then was like, oh, I feel real, I feel bad right now.
Yeah. And that, I mean.
And then you have silly episodes like Almost Got Him, which is serious, I'm not joking, is an episode to where the Joker, Poison Ivy, Killer Croc, and the Penguin... and Harvey Dent are sitting down playing poker.
Uh-huh.
And they're telling stories of how they almost got the bat.
Yeah.
And it's like four short stories, like four short episodes, basically, being told from the villain's perspective.
It's like those Tales of Bossing Say episodes of Avatar the Last Airbender.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like... they range from...
I mean, not exactly the same, but...
they range from the real silly things to where, like, Harvey Dent has Batman strapped to the giant penny.
Yep.
And then, Killer Croc was like, this one time I had Batman stuck in a corner. Uh-huh. And then I threw a rock at him! And everyone just kind of looks at him like... it was a big rock.
I've got your scent, Batman.
And, like, what's even sillier, though, is at the end of the episode, like, the cops are the other patrons in it.
Yeah.
So they basically got a confession from all of them. And Killer Croc was actually Batman in disguise. It's so stupid, but it's the greatest episode. like the light comes off of Killer Croc, and then it's just like these in the darkness. It's so great. Like, so much of Batman the Animated Series was like, this Like, these are episodes that adults can enjoy and kids will love.
Yeah.
And then there are episodes to where adults will love and kids will enjoy.
And they introduced us to the greatest Batman voice actor and
Kevin Conroy.
Greatest Joker voice actor.
Luke Skywalker.
Mark Hamill. Yeah.
Why can't be both?
He is both.
And also, the animated series is responsible for giving us... she's over there. Also responsible for giving us Harley Quinn.
Yeah.
Fun facts.
Yeah.
Because she was not part of anything beforehand. And they're like, what if we gave Joker a sidekick? So they came up with Harley Quinn, and DC's like, I like it.
And what's crazy is, like, the way they handled Harley Quinn and the Joker as an abusive relationship. Like, I've seen some of those clips from the animated series, like, yeah. of like, legit domestic violence, like, PSAs going on in this children's Batman cartoon.
Yeah.
It's like, what?
Yeah.
And what's great is just like all these fucking people when Suicide Squad was coming out, like, I want a relationship like Joker and Harley Quinn. And even in that movie,
that's a very strange relationship.
Even in that movie, like, Joker fucking fries her brain and pushes her into a vat of toxic waste.
Yeah, but let's be honest. Of the Joker incarnations and Harley Quinn incarnations, that's the best couple that they've been. Like, they actually kind of care about each other.
Yeah.
Sometimes. Like, Harley Quinn... For a while, like, was just obsessed with the Joker, and the Joker's like, meh.
Go away, Harley.
Yeah. Like, she was basically a means to get out of Arkham that one time, and now he's stuck with her.
Yeah.
And so she's kind of a valuable asset, but...
But there's a whole episode where Harley Quinn, to impress the Joker, like... captures Batman is about to kill Batman, and the Joker's like, no!
Yeah.
But I thought you wanted to kill the Batman. Only if I do it! And then he throws her out a fucking window!
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, like, the dynamic that they have is
this cute little thing. With the dog.
That's a hyena.
The dog wasn't there.
The hyenas were there. In the animated series.
At that point.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Maybe. They might have been in that episode, actually.
Yeah, they might have been in the episode, but they weren't there when she got thrown.
But yeah, like...
They might have been there. I don't care.
Catwoman was great in that show as well. Yeah. She showed up all the time. And then you were also introduced to, like, some other DC characters who, like... happened to be in Gotham a lot. Like, Zatanna showed up in Batman the Animated Series a few times, which is pretty cool. And then, like, there'd be these cool things. And then, the studio decided, you know, what if we did a Superman show, too?
Yeah.
So they started doing that, and that was going well. And so,
we did a Justice League show, too?
Well, hold on. Because, like, the art styles were looking so different.
Yeah.
They decided to bring Batman up with the Superman show. So now, then we got the revamp, which season 4.
Yeah. Because, Batman, original Batman the Animated Series was kind of pudgy all over. Like, he's kind of large all the spots.
They looked more realistic.
Kinda.
Well, like, they were blocky, But yeah. They look more realistic.
They did look more proportional, like, in all the spots.
Yeah, because once they went to season 4 and kind of went into that DCU look, like, everything changed.
Everyone skipped leg day.
Yes, kind of, and no. The women kind of did.
Well, yeah, the women have thighs because.
But here was the thing though. Like, they changed how everything looked.
Yeah.
And it was really, really strange.
Well, especially because like you go from season 3 to season 4, like, what happened?
There is that, but like some people got like updates for the better, like Scarecrow.
Yeah.
Went from a dude like in a red shirt that looked like he was in a Scarecrow costume into looking like the fucking Grim Reaper with still that same voice coming out of his mouth.
I love what they did to the Scarecrow in Arkham Knight.
Yeah.
Like, he looked genuinely scary.
Yeah. But like, Scarecrow carried around a scythe, had a noose wrapped around his neck, and it was still that, like, really calm baritone voice coming out of this terrifying figure.
Did you watch it was kind of like a series of short Batman things that was supposed to quote-unquote bridge Batman Begins and the Dark Knight? It was Batman Gotham Knight.
I don't think so.
There was a Scarecrow story in there that had the Scarecrow with the scythe, and he was terrifying. And, like, those were, like, gritty PG-13 Batman stories.
Mm.
So, like, it was...
Ugh. Yeah.
Like, there was some violence going on with that scythe.
Yeah. And, like, but then you had, like, real, real bad updates, like, the Joker became Mickey Mouse. Because, like, beforehand, he was, like, what he looked like in Master of the Phantasm. Like, he had the yellow teeth, the yellow eyes, like, green in his hair. Season 4 took the color out of the Joker, and he kind of, like, his hair was black with, like, green sheens.
Yeah.
His teeth were whiter. He just became, like, pale as this sock.
Man.
Can't see the sock. There it is. And, like, his eyes just became, like, dark recesses and little, like, white poop pupils.
I hate that Joker.
Yeah. But it was still Mark Hamill's voice.
Yeah, no.
And, like, the women... I don't know why, but they decided that they were all college girls now.
Yeah.
And just, like, little tiny things. But, like, not even that. Like, the animated series, they looked like women.
Yeah.
And then this, they looked like they just got out of class.
Yeah, I...
And also had all the color drained out of them.
Everything.
There was a lot of color just drained out of them, which is real strange.
They tried to make it more like a Tim Burton movie.
10 years later? That was inspired by the Tim Burton movies in the first place?
Yes. Yes.
But, yeah, so, and, like, what was cool about it, though, was, like, Robin became Nightwing.
Yeah.
And brought in Tim Drake as young Robin.
Yeah.
And we had Batgirl. So, like, there were good things about it, but then there was also really, really stupid decisions.
Well, that's part of why it ended.
Yes and no, because then we got Justice League and Batman Beyond.
Well, it didn't exactly end, but, like, that Batman the Animated Series did not continue to exist.
Although, what was funny was, in one of those episodes, they threw a kind of a giant haymaker at Joel Schumacher.
Yeah.
Like, there's this kid
fantasizing over Batman being in the tight leather suits, being all muscly and strong, while he's holding this, like, a boa. And they're like, that's not what Batman is at all, Joel. Like, shut up, Joel.
Yeah.
But, and so, then we get to Batman Beyond, which people, like, love it or hate it, which is kind of strange.
I kind of don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, it's not that I don't like it. Like, I love it as a concept.
Yeah.
Like, I love the idea of, like, futuristic versions of superheroes. Like, I love the idea of Spider-Man 2099. I love the idea of, like, Batman Beyond. Like, it's really cool. It's a cool concept. But that show is ugly as hell.
I will give you that, yeah.
Like, it's ugly as hell.
It continued kind of that colorless thing.
Yeah.
And I don't
like it.
Which is weird because, like, a lot of the set pieces are real colorful at times.
Yeah, because it's the future.
Yeah, but then, like, all of the people are...
Welcome to the future!
And, like, all the people are just kind of gone. Like, the most colorful villain that I can think of is not any of the Joker gang, but rather the guy who was running Wayne Industries, who becomes... Oh, what's his name? Like... He becomes radioactive, so he's this green and black skeleton.
Yeah.
He's the most colorful thing.
He's Skeletor.
Basically. Only more menacing, somehow. Yeah.
I am not nice.
But, like, he's got green and black and orange on him from his tattered clothes.
Yeah.
Like, because the show... I love it at times, because there's some great things in that show.
It's a cool concept, there are some great episodes, and
Return of the Joker is great.
Return of the Joker is one of the best Batman animated movies ever. But that show is ugly as hell.
Oh yeah.
Like, it doesn't look very good, there is some crappy episodes, and that Batman design is so minimalist.
Mm.
Like, I'm okay. But
that wouldn't that kind of be how Batman is in the future? Is the problem.
Dog, I want that fucking... what they've got in the Arkham Knight DLC for Batman Beyond, which is like a fucking robot Batman suit.
Yeah.
Like, that's what should be... Batman in the future.
Yeah.
Like, Batman should become Iron Man in the future.
I mean, he kind of does in a couple episodes, because old Bruce Wayne, like, gets out a fucking bat mech.
Yeah. I love the Batbot in fucking The Batman. It looks like Toothless.
Yeah.
Training Dragon.
we'll get to that.
Yeah.
So, like, after that, we had Justice League, which...
Everybody skipped leg day.
Everyone skipped leg day, but honestly...
You wouldn't...
That's what fucking DC should be going after right now. Yeah, well, so Warner good. Brothers, rather.
No, I'm not saying the art style for Justice League is bad. Because...
And they even are, because Justice League action is a thing.
Yeah, but the animation for Justice League is pretty great, and the voice acting is pretty great, especially Kevin Conroy.
Kevin Conroy, all the guys from Superman, because Superman, honestly, that's still the Superman that I think of
when
I think of Superman, because he's got that stoicness to him.
Yeah.
Like, none of the Batman movies that I've seen have had a stoicness.
You mean Superman?
Yes, Superman.
Yeah.
Because, like, he's supposed to be the Uberman.
Yeah.
He's supposed to be the pinnacle of what good can be.
I love that meme that's going around of Justice League where it's Batman in this big thing. Like, you wouldn't hit a girl, would you? The hammer of justice is unisex.
Yeah.
It's great.
It's so great. And like just, it also has like the best thing of Aquaman ever.
Yeah, and that galaxy trotting feel of the story, like the series, just like how far it spans, straight from the like isn't the pilot Martian Manhunter series? Yeah, yeah. Like they start
when the, like white Martians attack.
Yeah, they start you out with, like space shit happening.
Yeah, like Superman can't fight this alone, so he gets all his buddies.
Yeah, and they're just like right from the beginning, like, all right, this could go anywhere, at any time.
And then there's an episode to where Flash is on trial in space.
Yeah, and that's what Justice League that's what Justice League should be. It's just like sometimes it's on Earth, sometimes it's in space, sometimes it's in ancient Greece, sometimes
sometimes it's time travel, sometimes it's parallel universe. Like, it's something that deserves the Justice League.
Yeah, and that's great.
Yeah.
And that's what the Avengers movies is doing.
Yeah.
Like, what the Avengers movies are doing.
That's why it's worked.
Yeah, and what the Avengers movies are doing is, like, every singular story is going to have a story that pertains exclusively to this superhero.
Yeah.
And they don't really need anybody else. It's going to feel cataclysmic for that character, but if they had their teammates with them, they would probably not have to worry about jack shit.
Yeah.
So, like, but, like, this...
Shouldn't we be calling the Avengers or something?
Yeah. I think they're too busy dropping cities out of the sky. But I love Batman. Anyway.
I love all those movies.
Batman.
Batman! We're talking about Batman! Batman as Marvel.
Yeah, and that's what the Avengers movies are doing, that's what the Justice League series was doing, and that's what the Justice League movies should be doing, but they're failing.
Yeah.
But we'll talk about that later.
We'll get to it.
We're close.
we're in this millennium now.
Yeah, but Batman...
We had Justice League, and then there was Justice League Unlimited, which was basically even more ridiculous.
Yeah. What's your...
Because they're like, let's just bring in all these other superheroes that you've probably never heard of.
I hadn't seen Green Arrow until then.
and like, here. Have you heard of Shining Knight?
Who?
Shazam! Captain Marvel.
Who?
Shazam!
Oh. Oh, okay.
Why are you a kid?
Shazam!
But, like, which was honestly the greatest thing ever, because it introduces you to so many superheroes that I would have never known about before.
Yeah.
So it's like, I like that character. I kind of want to go read his comics now.
Yeah.
It's like, Shining Knight sounds interesting. He's a knight of the round table in the future with indestructible armor.
Yep.
Real niche comic.
Yeah.
Sounds pretty cool.
Yeah.
Stargirl. I had heard the name.
Yeah.
No idea what she was.
Yeah.
Dr. Fate. He shows up. Who was he? Oh, he's basically Dr. Strange on steroids, isn't he?
Dr.
Fate. he's got kind of a Lich King mentality to him.
Yeah.
There must always be a Dr. Fate.
Yeah.
So it's like,
or a Doctor Who thing.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
Based on the very limited knowledge I have of Doctor Who,
like, Dr. Fate is in the helmet, and you have to wear the helmet. And once you do, you kind of lose yourself, and you're kind of mixed in with Dr. Fate.
You are Cheetos Mac and Cheese now.
Yeah. And so, like, Dr. Fate can't exist without a host, and once that happens, well, fuck, they're gone.
They're Dr. They are Cheetos mac and cheese now.
But, like, Justice League dealt with some real heavy shit.
Yeah.
A lot.
That first, that first few episodes.
That first few episodes.
Jesus H. Christ. That, I remember watching that, that, Martian Manhunter series as a kid. And I was like, oh my, what? How are they going to get out of this one?
Yeah.
And the thing is, going back, I thought that was, like, way late in the series. And then I later found out that's the first episode.
Yeah.
Well, the first two or three episodes.
Yeah, because what they did, they didn't just abruptly end a story. They just told the whole story, which was great.
Yeah.
And, like, kept you on your toes for, like, what's going to happen next week?
Yeah.
Tune in next week. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Yeah.
But, like, they dealt with, like, racism shit.
Yeah.
They dealt with, like, the meaning of life. Like, real heavy shit. And then, like, the last episode was, basically about how Hot Girls people used to worship Cthulhu. All right. And, Cthulhu was mad and, like, starts messing with shit.
Because
no one worships him anymore. Oh, so he's, like, gonna drive people mad and whatnot.
Oh,
He's Cthulhu 2 to avoid copyright with H.P. Lovecraft. But, like,
Cthulhu.
This is the end of... Yeah, no. So, it's basically, like, are gods... do gods exist and what are they type of thing?
Do gods exist and what if they're pissed?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why does God need a starship?
Shut up, Star Trek.
But then, like, the ending of Justice League Unlimited was they have to sacrifice Solomon Grundy.
Yeah.
Oh, no, that was the end of Justice League Regular, Justice League Classic. Like, in order for Cthulhu to be, like, dead and gone...
Yeah.
They have to sacrifice Solomon Grundy, and they can never bring him back.
Well,
and so the heroes have to kill someone, like, on their own terms.
Yeah,
not, like, flipping a car and, oh shit, there was a dude inside that pancake.
Well, I mean, is Solomon Grundy really alive?
Yeah.
Because
he kind of cares for Hot Girl in the episode. So it's like, oh. And that's what makes Hot Girl quit and not show up in Justice League Unlimited for,
yeah,
like, a season.
Yeah, and then people pissed.
No?
Yeah, because nobody gave a shit about Hot Girl,
which,
does it?
Which is unfortunate, because Hot Girl's pretty great.
She's pretty cool.
Yeah.
But nobody gives a shit about Hot Girl.
Yeah.
She's just a girl with wings.
And a anti-magic mace.
Yeah. It's Hot Boy, too.
I could give literal no fucks.
We don't talk about
him. I could give no fucks. But,
yeah.
Then, like, we've got the Batman Begins...
What's your favorite Batman animated movie? Is it Mask of the Phantasm?
I think it is.
For my money, I think it's Under the Red Hood.
Like, Under the Red Hood is good, but I think Mask of the Phantasm is,
even though I don't really like John DiMaggio's Joker.
I think it's interesting.
I'm not a fan, but that's just me. But I don't really like John DiMaggio's Joker, but that's not really a Joker story. I mean, it kind of is, but not really.
He was Red Hood. It was his hood, Mr. Bat. He was number one.
Yeah. Well, I love Under the Red Hood because, like, it's I don't know. I didn't know the Jason Todd story.
Yeah, neither did I going into that.
So, like, I knew Robin died, but I didn't know, like, some of the darker
details. Which Robin? Yeah.
Because
the other one died by a landmine, and there was this guy
yeah.
who was brutally beaten and then brought back through Lazarus Pit.
Blown up.
that too. And then Lazarus Pit.
And then Lazarus.
What if bears?
I love Under the Red Hood, and I love that that.
And there's Damian Wayne.
Yeah. I love who they got to play Batman. That was dope.
Yeah. But I love Mask of the Phantasm and Return of the Joker.
Yeah.
Return
of the Joker is...
I kind of remember watching Sub-Zero.
Yeah.
But I don't remember it.
That probably means it's not great.
Although, I will say that in Season 4 Batman the Animated Series and Sub-Zero, Mr. Freeze being a head spider is the scariest thing... in existence.
Yeah. But,
what if I just crawled outside of my suit and this spider legs?
Yeah.
You're just a head. No! No! Get back in your body! I don't have a body anymore.
Return of the Joker is good. Mask of the Phantasm is good. This is stupid, but I love the Batman versus Dracula.
I kind of remember that, but I watched it long ago and I don't remember it.
I rented that shit from Blockbuster at least 3 times.
Yeah.
First off,
Joker as a vampire.
Yeah.
That fucking scene is incredible. Here, kids, this is what addicts are like.
That is probably the most dramatic scene in all of The Batman.
I'm sorry.
The Batman.
Yeah.
And all of The Batman, because, like, that part where Batman finds Vampire Joker in the blood bank... And, like, they're kicking over the shelves, and it's just raining blood. And Joker's, like, standing there receiving the blood rain.
Yeah.
What the hell has this become? Yeah. This was a Batman movie.
I do remember those, but Dracula himself, I don't remember anything.
Nah, the best parts of that were... The Penguin and Vampire Joker.
Did he learn that from the Orient?
Another trick I picked up in the Orient.
Let's talk about the Batman.
Oh my god, let's talk about the Batman!
We mentioned Batman Begins, and after that, the Batman happened.
Yeah, okay, so Batman Begins... You know what Batman Begins is, but it's the beginning...
With Ra's al Ghul.
Yeah, with Ra's al Ghul.
Free flow in combat.
It's mine now. That's more dangerous.
Let me wire cut your nipples.
but Batman Begins was the beginning of the Christopher Nolan Batman series.
You don't say.
Yeah, I do.
Batman Begins. Begins?
Yeah.
It was basically a Batman revival.
It was definitely the revival of Batman after a long dormancy.
After the Ice Age!
a revival of live-action Batman movies after a long dormancy. And...
Because, like, Justice League Unlimited ran until, like, 2004. Yeah. And then it was done.
Yeah, and introduced me to Christian Bale. More older people probably knew Christian Bale from
Before then.
American Psycho and other stuff, but introduced me to Christian
Midsummer Night's Dream.
Yeah, and he is great. He's, like, as a person, he's kind of a piece of shit, but as an actor, he's pretty great. Like, in the Batman movies, in American Psycho, in American Hustle, and even in Public Enemies, just, he's in a lot of really good movies. He's in some shitty movies.
Yeah.
Like Terminator Salvation. He's not great in that.
Yeah.
Well, he's okay.
Everyone's kind of not great in that movie.
He's okay, but, like, the writing is terrible. Like, there's a part in that movie where John Connor says, "Find Kyle Reese. Tell me if he's alive." You wouldn't exist if he wasn't.
We don't know how time flows in the Terminator universe, though, because...
No, you wouldn't exist if he wasn't.
But would he? Wouldn't he?
He wouldn't.
Nobody would exist at that point, but also they might be stuck in... It depends on the type of time travel we're going.
Yeah,
that's... If it's Back to the Future, none of the resistance would have disappeared once Kyle Reese died.
Yeah.
Humanity would have actually died.
Yeah.
But if it's working off of, like other time travel things...
Yeah.
Like, we'll use Dragon Ball Z as an example. Might not be the best, but it's like, whenever, like, Trunks comes back, stops the androids, and defeats Cell, like, his timeline is unaffected.
Yeah, so, like,
when he goes back in time, the androids are still there and all these bad things, and he just kind of, like, obliterates them because he's so much more powerful now.
Yeah.
So then, like, he saves his timeline, but the timeline that he went to maybe save his... is now on a different course. So, like, different
kind of
times.
Kind of like the J.J. Abrams Star Trek movies and Looper.
Yeah. So it's like, time travel can be weird, so based on what rules you use, Kyle Reese could be dead and John Connor still be alive because Kyle Reese existed beforehand.
Yeah, but some bad shit's gonna go down. But it... Okay.
Time travel's a mess. Let's move on before we get too deep.
I want to say one thing, though. If time travel works the way John Connor is hoping it does, which is to send back Kyle Reese to stop the Terminators from happening in their time, if Kyle Reese is dead, he wouldn't exist.
Yeah.
So why are you asking this question?
Yeah.
Anyway.
But, yeah, time travel's confusing. No one knows for sure, because as far as we know, we haven't done it.
Yeah. Batman Begins was the Batman resurgence in the live-action department, and kind of the first... really well done serious drama superhero movie.
Uh-huh.
And my only issue with it is that it takes itself too seriously.
Oh, for sure.
Like, The Dark Knight is a significantly darker story.
Yeah.
But doesn't take itself nearly as seriously. Mm-hmm. Like, it allows itself to overstep the boundaries of what would normally be reality in a lot of spots, and has some humor. Like, it's very dark and dry humor, but it's there.
Yeah.
And it has some humor, and
ta-da!
The cataclysm of how big everything that is happening is feels massive.
Yeah.
And the issue with Scarecrow's plan in Batman Begins, even though it affects the entire city, the way the movie is paced and the way it works makes it kind of feel like all this stuff is happening to just Bruce Wayne. And that's kind of an issue that they fixed in a big way in The Dark Knight and The Dark Knight Rises. But, yeah. I feel like, in a lot of ways, The Dark Knight saved... Batman Begins saved superhero movies, but other ways, I feel like it kind of set DC on a bad path.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about that in a second.
But the animation, though, is, like ever since then, is still fantastic.
Yeah. With the exception of Batman the Brave and the Bold.
Hold on, we'll get to that. So we have the Batman.
Yeah.
Which, the character designs, like, a lot of them are real great, and then some of them are just very strange.
Yeah. The only one that I didn't really like was Bane.
Yeah, why did he turn red? Like, I mean, I can understand why he turned red.
Bane is, in the Batman, is like S&M Red Hulk.
Yeah.
Like, it's stupid.
Yeah, it's real stupid.
And he's only in one episode, but like,
I thought he was in a couple.
I think he's only in one, but he might have been in another one. But
like, Kevin Michael Richardson as the Joker, like, sounds very strange at first, but then it kind of all works out in the end.
I love him.
Because, yeah.
I love
Kevin Michael Richardson is a great voice actor.
I love him. I love the demented hobo.
Yeah.
Like, I love his look. I love his voice. I love the attitude of him, because he is the funniest Joker I have witnessed.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he's just over the top, just so crazy. And what's great about him is he feels about as unpredictable as the Joker should.
Mm-hmm.
Which, there are some instances where even Mark Hamill's Joker doesn't feel as unpredictable as the Joker should.
Yeah.
There are spots where he does, but the way the Joker in The Batman is written and created, and one of the biggest sins of The Batman is they kind of decide to lean on the Joker a little bit too much.
Yeah.
Which I don't have a problem with, because he's awesome.
Yeah.
And Kevin Michael Richardson is great. But they lean a lot on the Penguin and the Joker because
they could get them so much easier, because
you can get,
it's Kevin Michael Richardson and Tom Kenny, aka SpongeBob.
Yeah, you can get Kevin Michael Richardson and Tom Kenny in a pinch, regardless whatever the hell is going on.
Yeah.
But it kind of feels like they're just like, what?
Like, as funny as it is, I'm still a little bit weirded out, like, why they made the Penguin, like, an Orient-obsessed criminal.
No, it's stupid.
I know, but it's like, why? Why is it just called the Orient?
It's another trick I picked up in the Orient.
And his fucking laugh.
That's just...
This is great. I don't know how Tom Kenny, like, functions as a man.
And I love Clancy Brown as
everyone.
the fucking Mr. Freeze. It's like Clancy Brown's Mr. Freeze is the tongue-in-cheek, like, ice puns that you would expect from silly Mr. Freeze.
Yeah.
But at the same time, is scary Mr. Freeze. Well, like, it's big, scary Mr. Freeze walking out of a bank, spraying ice all over the fucking place, saying, "Baby, it's cold outside."
In his, like, deep bass.
Yeah, it's phenomenal.
Yeah.
Well, let's start moving a little bit quicker because it's getting late.
Yeah, it's no longer Batman Day.
Yeah.
it's over. It's died.
let's get moving a little bit quicker.
Then we had Dark Knight and the Dark Knight Rises.
The Dark Knight,
you know about those.
The Dark Knight is one of my favorite films made ever, and I think The Dark Knight Rises is close to on par with it, which I know is blasphemy.
Everything's blasphemy.
To someone, yeah. I love The Dark Knight Rises. I love Tom Hardy's Bane.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Yeah. The only problem was they had
the only problem issue was with he the theater. Was, the only problem was he was Bane. Why was he Bane? He should have been somebody else.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, they couldn't have done the backbreaking.
Like, in terms of needing somebody devastating, of course it was Bane.
Why can't it be Bane?
here's the thing. They're just like, okay, we need Bane because we need this kind of Batman Nightfall mixed with Dark Knight Returns type of situation. So, like, we need Bane because we need somebody who can physically overpower Batman. But we also need that kind of psychological, like, what are they thinking type of thing that we've been doing since the fucking beginning.
Yeah.
And they looked at Bane and they're like, why can't we both? Because that's not what Bane is. But that's fine. It's a fucking incredibly written character.
Unvenomed
Bane. Okay, yeah, unvenomed Bane, you're right. And it was unvenomed Bane. But unvenomed Bane isn't as just physically devastating. He is. He's a big dude, but like...
He can curl 400 pounds!
Yeah, but that Bane couldn't.
No, but...
In Batman Nightfall, it's venomed Bane that breaks Batman's back.
Yeah.
And that would kill a man.
Yeah. That wouldn't break his back, that would break him in half and rip him.
No, but it's an incredibly written character, incredibly acted, and unless you're seeing it in theaters, which unfortunately is the way it's been tended to be seen, the voice is real bad in the theaters because it's too bassy.
It was the first 2 weeks of that movie being out.
Yeah.
They went back and fixed it, but like it was so, like in the priority charts of the audio, basically.
It was at the top.
It was at the top, so it was just like, welcome, everyone! What's he saying? The speakers can't comprehend it. But the speakers couldn't keep up with the sound.
Yeah, that was the only bad thing about that movie is because, like, it's just like,
because the editors fucked up something.
Yeah,
fucked up real bad. But, no, I love
this is from Gotham Police Commissioner.
I'm sorry, there's something on your face.
And that's... it wasn't supposed to be silly, but it turned out being silly because nobody could understand. And the thing is, he has the best lines in the movie. So when you go back and see it on DVD, you're like, this is an incredible character. Why didn't I know that before? Oh, wait.
I couldn't understand a word of you.
And that was the only issue. Like, people complain that, like, there's not enough Batman in my Batman movie. Fuck you. Go fuck yourself. Today. Immediately. You could die and I'd be glad you're dead.
I was glad, I'll be glad right away. But so after those, we had Batman Brave and the Bold. I know you hate it with a passion.
It's too stupid for me.
Yeah, but that was kind of the point. It was
I don't care.
It was like, bring back the Silver Age Batman, which is real silly, so you can have some family-friendly fun.
Here's the thing. I don't like the Silver Age Batman. I like something between Batman 1989 and what we have now.
Hmm.
Like
Golden Age.
Yeah.
Golden Age Joker and Batman and whatnot.
Good shit. Good
yeah.
Shit. Real good shit.
But like I still kind of liked Batman Brave and the Bold because it kinda had that Justice League Unlimited thing to where it's like, here's this dude you probably never heard of. Okay.
Okay.
And it makes fun of itself.
I haven't watched
it. It knows it's silly and stupid. Yeah,
I don't know. There's a time and a
place. Aquaman is Justice Friends Aquaman.
Yeah, I know. Most of what I've seen is an Aquaman episode. I'm like, this is so dumb.
And the Joker that they got...
is Brent Spiner.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Like, I understand it from, like, looking at their Joker. That is how I would imagine him sounding like, with his big, giant mouth.
Yeah.
So, I get it. I'm not a big fan of it.
No,
but
it's bad.
It's real silly.
I don't like that show.
It's fine.
That's okay. I don't like it.
After those, we've had like some other video games like DC Online, Injustice.
I love Injustice.
And so now we're here to modern day, where we had Batman vs. Superman.
Okay, we had Batman vs. Superman. And, okay, we're talking about Batman tonight.
Yeah.
Batman's the best part of that movie.
Oh, yep, yeah. Well, Alfred is the best part of that movie.
Alfred is the best part of that movie.
The Batman assets of that movie are great.
And Ben Affleck as Batman...
Yeah.
Is great.
Yeah.
Like, he played that character as good as he could have been expected to. The problem was, Zack Snyder doesn't know how to write anything. I'm sorry, Zack Snyder didn't write that movie. David S. Goyer did. And David S. Goyer gets credit for co-writing The Dark Knight, but that's a Jonathan and Christopher Nolan script. David S. Goyer might have been there, and he might have written some stuff, but David S. Goyer is not a good writer.
No.
Like, he's kind of bad, and Zack Snyder doesn't know how to shoot what he is trying to call a mature superhero film. Because Zack Snyder is a 12-year-old boy. Like, the Watchmen.
Mm-hmm.
Exhibit A. I love the Watchmen comic book. Like, in terms of literature I have read, Watchmen is not just one of my favorite graphic novels of all time. I think it is my favorite graphic novel of all time.
Yeah.
And it's I think it might be my favorite book. period.
Yeah.
Of all time. Because it's just the existential drama about it. Like, how it deals with the existence of deities and how superheroes would affect the Cold War, and along with some other political changes, like the fact that Richard Nixon is still president in 1985, and along with a bunch of other stuff. If the Cold War escalated, was about to escalate a little bit further and become hot, and there were superheroes, so the U.S. doesn't have nuclear weapons anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, just that whole thing, a lot of that stuff, like, the background stuff that's not just the character interaction, doesn't translate in the movie whatsoever. Which partially is an editing issue.
Mm.
Because David Hayter wrote that Watchmen adaptation, and it is widely accepted as one of the best script adaptations of a comic book ever. And it's good.
Mm.
Like, it is a good adaptation of a comic book. The way it is handled by the actual filmmaking, not so much.
Mm.
Like, the way it looks is way too juvenile and overly comic booky, and Watchmen is a violent comic book. Like, there is some graphic stuff that happens in there, but it's not over the top and in your face.
It's not 300.
Yeah, and there's a scene in the comic book that is kind of incredibly innocuous, which is weird because it's Night Owl and Silk Spectre getting mugged. But, like, the way it's handled in the comic book is, like, there's a voiceover happening, they get mugged, and they beat up these guys and then go along their way because they're fucking superheroes. Well, they're masked adventurers,
mm-hmm.
which is what they're called in the comic book, but to avoid the silliness that is inherent with the term superhero.
Well, vigilantes.
Yeah. But they call them masked adventurers.
All right.
But, but, like, in the movie, it is a 300 scene. Like, that part, Night Owl takes a dude's arm and punches the back of it, and the bone comes out, and blood spills all over the camera. Like, it's ridiculous. And that's not what that's supposed to look like.
Yeah.
This visual style is strange for what this comic book is.
Mm.
Like, there are parts where it works. Like, when shit is actually going down, you can make it look like that.
Yeah.
But when shit's not going down, it shouldn't look like that.
No.
And it loses all the subtlety that makes Watchmen.
I am Jesus! I am Jesus!
It loses all the subtlety that makes Watchmen Watchmen. And yeah, they kind of treat
Superman.
And in Man of Steel.
And Batman v Superman.
And Batman vs. Superman.
And they, Justice League, probably.
They treat Superman like just a god. Which is fine if you want to do that.
Yeah.
But do it right. Because, focus on that.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't.
No.
Like, they had it there, and I'm like, okay, this is cool. Like, the first time I saw that part of the trailer with the Superman statue and the words "false god" sprayed on his chest.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, if you're gonna do this, I'm fucking down. But they didn't do it.
No.
They had that as a petty reason for everyone to hate Superman, and then didn't really touch it. No. They could have gone deeper. But they had David S. Goyer writing their script.
Yeah.
And it was bad. And the only issue with the Watchmen adaptation is the fact that it had to be trimmed down as much as it is, because Watchmen is a big comic book.
Yeah.
Like, should have been two movies. Could have been two movies.
Could have been three movies.
Yeah. But, like, it's... I don't know.
Yeah.
Zack Snyder is just... needs to fucking stop it or learn what...
He needs to not touch things that we love and do things of his own.
Maybe.
Because, like, I think he needs to learn how to make a movie on his own instead of using a product and turning it into a movie with what he thinks it should be, but people know what it actually should be.
Yeah.
Because, like, 300, like, Frank Miller, it looks basically what, like, a Frank Miller movie would look like.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I haven't seen it, so I don't really have a lot to say about it.
It's fucking beautiful.
Yeah. But, it was a success, so he's like, oh, this is how movies are made. This is how you do them right. But that doesn't work with everything.
It was a success, but... I haven't read the 300 comic book, so bear with me, guys. But,
it's in Pulp Fiction.
I know. I need to read it.
It's in color.
I know. Not all Frank Miller comics are black and white.
I know.
I love Sin City.
It's real pretty.
Frank Miller... People shit on Frank Miller's style because, yeah, it's fucking weird.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's fucking weird and really ugly. But there's like, beauty in the ugliness.
Yeah. A diamond in the rough.
Yeah, it's good.
You know, speaking of Frank Miller, Dark Knight Returns.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about Dark Knight
Returns? Yeah, let's talk about a good movie real quick before we get to Suicide Squad.
I wanted to keep talking about Batman vs. Superman.
We haven't talked about Batman vs. Superman. You've been talking about Zack Snyder.
Yeah, I was talking about Batman vs. Superman.
No, not yet.
That was the problem with Batman vs. Superman and David S. Goyer. man. Okay. Back to what I was saying about what they should have done with Watchmen. Like, mm-hmm. when shit's going down, you can look like that, but in other spots, you shouldn't. They did that right in Batman vs. Superman,
mm-hmm.
and in Man of Steel. It's like, on Krypton, yeah, needs to look like that.
Yeah.
In Kansas? No.
Unless Doomsday shows up on the Clark farm...
Yeah. No, but like one in Batman vs. Superman.
Not Doomsday, Darkseid.
Yeah.
Start with a D.
In Batman vs. Superman, like one thing that
yeah, it's early.
One thing that movie had going for it was the fact that the visual style felt consistent. And looked like it needed to look in the spots that it needed to look. The issue was the pacing,
mm-hmm.
the script,
mm-hmm.
and how fucking late in the Batman mythos Superman has come to Earth.
Yeah.
Like, we are post-Dark Knight Returns here.
Mm-hmm.
That's not when Justice League happens.
Yeah.
That's not... No. Batman's not killing people yet. But he is. In this movie.
He's too...
I respect human life way more than you do.
Yeah. First off, yeah. The subject you are covering is the fact that we can't trust this alien because he doesn't understand the fragility of human life. And yet, all the people who are arguing about... like, arguing with Superman and saying that Superman is bad have killed more people than Superman! Batman kills so many people.
And Lex Luthor brands them for execution.
Yeah. Lex Luthor kills so many people. Yeah, Superman killed a bunch of people in Man of Steel, but he, at least he did it on accident.
The Kryptonians were kind of making gravity work too good.
Yeah, and
in a very populated city.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, why wasn't Gotham affected? It was across the lake.
Also, that's not where Gotham City is. You can't see the bat signal from Metropolis.
Yeah. Well, like,
what did you do, guys?
It wrong. Because isn't Metropolis supposed to be like DC in the DC universe?
I don't fucking know.
Because Gotham's New York.
Yeah.
So what's Metropolis? Boston?
I feel like it's Seattle.
Really?
It seems like Seattle to me.
I thought that was something else.
It looks like Seattle to me.
Maybe.
Like, I don't know what the authors intend Metropolis to be, but...
Well,
like,
I think it was filmed in Seattle, so that's why.
Just the way... In the animated series, like in the comic books, I think Metropolis looks a little bit like what I have seen of Seattle.
Okay, maybe.
But I don't know what they want it to be, but that's what it looks like to me.
Yeah, because I think, like, Star City is, like, Philadelphia or Pittsburgh. Central City's Kansas City. Go Flash.
Flash!
Which is real convenient, because he's like, I need to be everywhere. Like, later on in his career, like, oh, I need to be in Metropolis?
They built this...
I'm halfway there from home.
They built this city in the exact... They built this church in the exact center of the city. The idea they had was so that everyone could be equally close to God. Everyone can be equally close to Flash.
Yeah. But, so yeah, I'm just wondering where exactly like Metropolis would be, because I feel like in comics it's nearby Gotham,
it's
but not that close.
It's not across the fucking.
It's not the same as
also,
like,
is it Metropolis?
Manhattan is Metropolis, and then like Brooklyn is Gotham. That's not how that works.
Isn't Metropolis landlocked in the comics too?
I thought it was on the ocean as well.
I mean,
because Superman gets to fight sea creatures then.
Okay. I don't know enough.
Or he can throw a bomb out into the ocean.
Okay. I don't know enough.
Hmm. But neither do I. But
maybe it is.
It's not across the fucking bay.
Yeah, that's the point we're making.
It's not across the Hudson.
But yeah, I don't know. Batman... I'm excited for Ben Affleck's Batman movie.
Yeah.
I hope it goes back in time. Please, God, do it. Just fucking do it.
Yeah.
Like,
Because
here's the thing. Like, they're playing Dark Knight Returns Batman.
Mm-hmm.
But Ben Affleck's not really old enough for that.
No.
And, like, they make him look old enough for that. Like, my issue isn't that he doesn't seem old enough. My issue is that...
I don't think he looks old enough in the movies, even.
My issue is that he doesn't have to be.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. It's a big issue. Like, start it where it's supposed to. Like, I know Zack Snyder has a huge boner for superheroes killing people. Like, he does. I saw an interview about Watchmen where he was talking about how back in the day he would read comic books, and he literally said this. He's like, and I was like, when do they start fucking killing people? He literally said, when do they start fucking killing people?
Yeah, that's a problem.
That's not what
Batman... Warner Brothers fire him.
I know you got just a big hard on.
Go read Deadpool or something.
Make a Blade movie, make a Punisher movie, make a movie about a character that actually is supposed to be killing people in the time that you're making the movie for it. Because yeah. Batman does kill people eventually. You can have that.
Yeah.
Just not yet. And he's back for Justice League. At least on IMDb it says he is. I thought I heard they fired him, but I guess not.
They, like, creative consulting him, like, with Lucas, and then firing him. Like, we need your style. I need you to help us with your style. Well, this is how you do it. All right, good, leave.
I want him gone.
Yeah.
I want him not making films.
Mm-hmm.
He makes bad movies.
Unless it's 300.
300 was... And here's the thing. 300's not even that great. Like, it's good.
For what it is.
For what it is, it's good. But it's not really that good. Like, okay. I had a discussion with... Well, I had a partial discussion with somebody about 300. And 300 Rise of an Empire is an even worse movie.
Yeah.
But Zack Snyder didn't direct it. He just wrote it. And ruined it. Because that movie, that movie sounds like it's written by a 12-year-old boy, which is awful. Like, there's this weird, like, hate fucking scene between the protagonist and the main female antagonist, and the only decent character in it is that main female antagonist until that weird
hate fucking
scene that doesn't need to be there.
Yeah.
Like, I get that you want to see Evergreen's tits, but bro.
Yeah.
Bro. It's... I don't know. It's not written very well. And it has... It looks gross.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the first movie was beautiful.
Yeah.
Like, positively gorgeous. In 300 Rise of an Empire, all the blood is, like, CG blood splatters. Like, full CG 3D modeled blood splatters. So it all looks like the smoke monster from Lost coming out of people. And it just looks like absolute shit.
Yeah.
And in 300, there were these parts where they would stab dudes and, like, they have these, like, kind of 2D splats come out and they will, like, get suspended in air and, like, there'd be this death of field effect. That movie is fucking gorgeous. 300 Rise of an Empire looks like trash from a toilet. It's so bad. And somebody made the argument that, yeah, 300 Rise of an Empire is a bad movie, but they argue that it's better than 300 because in 300 there is not a single character that is more than one dimensional. To which I say, you are incorrect. There is not a single person in 300 that is more than one-dimensional. But the character is Sparta.
Yeah.
The character in 300 is Sparta and Persia and their battle.
Yeah.
And that character is very much more than one-dimensional in that movie. But that's just how I look at it.
Yeah.
But we're talking about Batman.
Are we, though?
we're talking about comic books now. comic book movies.
You've been talking about Zack Snyder.
Yeah, he's...
ranting and raving.
He's so bad.
Crazy old Maurice. He was in here earlier raving. Slow down, Maurice.
And we should just do a whole video on Suicide Squad later. Like I don't have the energy to talk about Suicide Squad right now.
Yeah, but let's end on a good note of Batman. Because
what do you want to talk about?
Well, I mean, there is the Killing Joke, but also, like...
That's not really a good note.
Batman's pretty good in it. Yeah. Kevin Conroy's good, as always.
Yeah, unfortunately, but, Mark Hamill's not. He's not on par with himself.
He's got real old, and his voice kind of crapped out.
I know, but, like... It's not.
I'm afraid of, like, what's he's gonna sound like in Star Wars.
It's not the voice, though. It's not the voice, because the voice is still great.
Mm.
But it's just the way he read those lines.
Well, I think part of the problem was he was reading those lines because, like, once it got to that, it was so faithful that it wasn't really an adaptation anymore. So,
I don't know.
Like, it was kind of like reading Alan Moore's thought diarrhea, like, straight from the mouth.
Well, I don't know. The lines that I felt like needed to have impact,
mm-hmm,
didn't. Like, the end...
But that is also another thing.
The end was
great. It's your interpretation against the, like, directors or whatnot.
That's true, but the scene, the monologue before he sends Gordon into the Tunnel of Terror, like, that monologue needs to hit.
Mm-hmm.
And the way he read it,
mm-hmm,
was like he was just reading it.
Mm-hmm.
And that didn't feel right to me. And he changed a couple of lines to worse ones.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it didn't really flow right. And that scene, for me at least, is one of the most important scenes in the movie.
Yeah.
Like, he doesn't say madness is the emergency exit. He doesn't say that.
Yeah.
And that's one of the best parts of it, coupled with the rest of it.
Yeah.
Like, he says there's always madness. You can just walk outside and... You can just walk outside and forget all and close the door on all those dreadful things that happened. You can lock them away forever.
Mm-hmm.
But that feeling of, like, there's always madness. Madness is the emergency exit. You can just walk outside and close the door on all those dreadful things that happen. Like, madness is the emergency exit. It's just like, it is the thing that you will go to when nothing else makes sense anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And without that, you kind of lose the point a little bit for me.
Yeah.
And, like, that monologue might not mean nearly as much to everyone else.
Yeah.
But that kind of spoiled almost the whole thing for me.
Oh, no, that was the first 30 minutes.
No, like, the whole part that was actually the killing.
Oh, joke. The part that you consider the film?
Yes.
Yeah. But I don't know about you, but I'm excited for the future because Justice League Action is coming out, I think, pretty soon here.
Justice League Action looks like cool.
It's coming out this year.
That Dark Justice League movie that they preview on that Killing Joke Blu-ray we watched, that looks cool.
Yeah.
And I'm excited for the Batfleck movie. I'm excited for the Wonder Woman movie.
I want to be.
I'm excited for Batfleck. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you why.
Can it just be called that?
I want it to. I think it's going to be called The Batman. Like, that's a name they've been throwing out.
The Batman. Yeah.
That's a name they've been throwing out. Who knows if that'll be it, but whatever. Here's why. Like, the writer and director for Suicide Squad did one good thing and hasn't done much else that good since.
Yeah.
So, like, there was always a looming feeling like, maybe this won't be good.
Yeah.
I don't know much about who's making the Wonder Woman movie, but I know that trailer looks gorgeous, and it looks like all the good parts of Captain America the First Avenger, which I'm excited about. I like Chris Pine. I like that woman they have playing Wonder Woman. I like the time that they have it in, because they're going back in time, like I think everything should be.
Yeah.
Why the fuck does Suicide Squad take place after Dawn of Justice? What the hell are you doing, guys?
Does it?
It does!
Okay, yeah.
They reference the death of Superman.
Yeah, that's right.
Which, why did you kill we're talking about Batman.
But that is a story for another time.
I don't know much about who's making the Wonder Woman movie, but I know that looks gorgeous, looks cool. The Suicide Squad movie didn't look that good in the like, it looked like the story might be fun and cool and stuff, but it visually...
Well, after Batman v Superman, we needed something fun.
Yeah, but visually it looked kind of flat and meh, except for that part where they were showing Joker jumping off of the thing, which is probably the best looking shot in that movie. Like, him jumping out into the toxic waste is pretty cool. Like, that's a good looking shot. The rest of that movie looks really, really bad. Like, it just looks terrible. But, yeah. But, the Batfleck movie, I have high hopes for, because I think it's all but officially confirmed that Deathstroke is gonna be there. We don't know if he'll be the main villain, but he's gonna be there.
I kind of hope so, cause like, as much as I love the Joker, they need to learn how to do other villains.
Yeah, no, I know, and I feel like Deathstroke, especially for Ben Affleck directing, is right up his alley, I think. Because, like, movies like The Town and parts of Argo, I think, lend themselves to what Deathstroke could be.
Yeah.
And also, Ben Affleck is a good director. I kind of wish he would write this movie.
Isn't he?
Is he? I don't know.
I thought he was... I had heard rumors that he was, like, trifecting.
If he writes this movie, I have a lot of hopes for it. Yeah. It's like...
My problem is I don't want to be disappointed again.
I know. But Ben Affleck is a good director.
Because despite what you think, I love DC.
Yeah, I know. I know.
But bad things have happened.
I know. No, I know. Oh, I know.
I feel like I'm Harley in this relationship.
Oh, I know. No, but like,
I'm gonna go to my redheaded friends.
for comfort.
Oh, I know.
That's real funny how that works out, actually.
But, no, Bat... Batfleck... A, Ben Affleck, in terms of the actor playing the character right, was the best part of Batman vs. Superman and Suicide Squad. Well, not Suicide Squad, because Margot Robbie was very good Harley Quinn.
Yeah.
But Ben Affleck's good Batman, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And Ben Affleck, I know, is a good director, and Ben Affleck... I don't know for a fact he's writing this, but if he is, he helped Matt Damon write Good Will Hunting.
Mm-hmm.
That movie's incredible.
Yeah.
Like, that is a very, very well-written movie. So, I feel like at least that Batman movie is gonna be alright.
Yeah, hopefully.
But
we can hope.
We can pray. It's like, again... Good Batman, good director, maybe good writer.
Yeah.
That Deathstroke B-roll that he tweeted out looks beautiful. Like, that character design I'm into.
Mm-hmm.
I'm all the way into that. But yeah, we have high hopes for the future of Batman and DC, but in terms of live-action movies, it's... Justice League looks like a dumpster fire that you could flush down a giant toilet.
Which is real disappointing.
Yeah. That Wonder Woman movie looks good, but who knows?
You know what honestly could fix Justice League?
What?
Is if they scrapped it right now, which would be a huge waste of money.
Yeah.
And they acknowledge the TV shows exist.
Maybe.
Because the Flash in the TV shows is fantastic.
Yeah.
That Flash is piss! That Flash is piss!
You don't know yet.
What I've seen of him in Suicide Squad...
Did you?
Yeah! He showed up with Captain Boomerang, remember?
We saw him for like a second.
Uh-huh. We've seen him in the trailers.
We saw him in the trailers for like a split second, and we saw him in
what him in the trailers. I don't care about the person at all, let alone him being the Flash.
You haven't given you haven't seen it.
I like looking at him, listening to him. I don't feel like he. Like, is actually a person.
Yeah.
Like, I kind of just already hate him. And that's not just because I've seen, like, The Flash and think that should be him. No, I'm looking at him and going, as a nerd, I would punch that guy.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't.
Like, I would, if I had to listen to him, I would just straight up deck him.
I don't like the lightning.
It's too much. Like, lightning just on the Flash when he's going, like, mega fast?
Yeah.
Yes, because friction applies.
Yeah.
But when he just kind of moves and then there's just a lightning storm in space effect around him?
And then he appears. When we saw him in... for the first time in that, a split second in Batman vs. Superman, I thought it was gonna be Shazam.
Yeah.
Even though I had no evidence of that. Like, cause A, lightning bolt symbol.
Yeah.
B, the lightning surrounded the person. And then it was Flash, and I wanted it to be Shazam.
Yeah, we have to wait until 2019.
Shazam!
I think it's 19 or 17, one of those. But,
I don't know.
Yeah, pretty beforehand awesome. He had, like, the man bun.
Yeah.
I was like, that's real stupid, get rid of that. And they got rid of that.
Speaking of characters that are sometimes named Marvel, What do you think of Brie Larson as Miss Marvel?
I don't think I've seen that. I don't know who that is. I need to look.
Okay, we'll talk about that later, but she's good.
We'll have a Marvel episode at some point.
Yeah. But yeah, I think we should close this out. I have high hopes for the future of Batman. I don't know about DC.
DC is kind of titanicking.
I think they need to just crumple it up like a Chipotle burrito and throw it in the trash and then roll a new one.
Yeah, because, like, if you're throwing that much money at that at all that garbage, but yet the animated series,
it's just series.
Okay. And your, like, live-action television series, if they're doing better,
yeah,
both commercially and, like, fan review, than your movies, and you're continuing to fund the movies more,
yeah,
you've got a problem.
Yeah.
Acknowledge what's actually good and reward those people.
Yeah.
Like, if they made the TV shows part of the world canon, like Marvel is doing,
yeah,
with like Daredevil and Jessica Jones and Luke Cage, like they're in the Marvel universe,
yeah,
and the Punisher.
All
right. Like, then you have the fun of Green Arrow and the Flash.
One quick thing though,
and Supergirl,
the the Netflix series, they're all together. But Joss Whedon, like, openly said, yeah, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. doesn't exist. Like, Marvel is an example in that those three and soon to be more,
Marvel. Well, Luke Cage, I think Luke Cage came out today, tomorrow? Like, real soon.
Real soon, and I think there's going to be something. I think they've got something else coming down the pipe, too.
Yeah.
But those ones are all together, and that's a cool Marvel universe that's going on Netflix. But in terms of Marvel being an example of, like, acknowledging their television programs, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. doesn't exist.
Agent Carter's part of...
They acknowledged Agent Carter because that character already existed.
Yes, and it was good.
Yeah, but nobody watched it. But
some people did.
Yeah, but
I haven't yet.
Joss Whedon.
I need to.
Joss Whedon was like, "Yeah, Agent Coulson's dead, guys."
Or is he?
No, he's dead, guys. And so, like, they just got scrapped Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is at least after Captain America the Winter Soldier, was reacting to the Marvel movies. But the Marvel movies are not reacting to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
No, actually.
Oh, really?
The beginning of Ultron.
Yeah.
Those Russian guys that were holding Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch.
Yeah.
They were actually villains in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, okay.
And, like, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. led up to Age of Ultron.
But Agent Coulson's dead.
Or is he?
Joss Whedon says he is. And Joss Whedon killed him.
Or did he?
Tune in next time.
And
same
also,
bat time, and same also, bat channel.
I'm fucking pissed off. And I texted you about this last night.
You did?
Yeah, you talked to me. I texted you about this last night, but, why the fuck? Because Ghost Rider's gonna be in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Mm-hmm.
Ghost Rider's driving a car!
Oh yeah, I do remember that now.
Why? He's not writing anything at that point. We'll talk about that later. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you made it to the end of this video, you are the real heroes. Tell us what you think of... Tell us.
Telk.
Telkum powder. Tell us what you think is going on with the DC Universe. Tell us what you want to see in the future DC Universe. And tell us what you think...
What your favorite Batman is.
Yeah, tell us what your favorite Batman is. Tell us what
incarnation, whether it be comic, movie, animated series, video game.
Yeah. Tell us what your favorite Batman is.
Those are kind of the same.
Tell us what your favorite Joker is. Tell us what your favorite everything Batman is.
Leave a video as long as this one in the comments section.
And we will watch it.
Yeah, I will.
Yeah, but thank you guys so much for watching this video. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe, and do all that fun social media stuff. We are going to try and do these Nerdcasts every week, and we're going to try and keep our other videos less than 2 hours. These will just be the real long ones, and the other ones will be pretty short.
I think we might also try to make these shorter, but we got off on tangents of Zack Snyder and Bat credit cards and... All these
We talked about that.
It's been like 3 hours.
Thank you guys so much for watching. Check out our future stuff. We're going to try and get back to form. Yeah. This is the start of our return to form. Thank you. Good night.
And goodbye.